A very good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have apologies this morning from Pauline McNeill, and Katie Clark is joining us online. So our main item of business today is consideration of an affirmative instrument, the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland Constitution, Arbitration and Qualifying Cases Regulations of 2023. And I'm pleased to welcome the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Angela Constance, and her officials to the meeting. So we're joined this morning by Peter Jemison, Police Division, Graham Thompson, Police Division, and Louise Miller, Legal Directorate of the Scottish Government. And I refer members to Paper 1. And I'd also like to refer members to Annex B in our briefing paper and thank the Scottish Police Federation for their comments. So I'd like to now invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to the instrument. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. The Criminal Justice Scotland Act 2016 provided for the establishment of the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland, and these regulations will give effect to the constitution of the new body. The constitution is published and linked in the regulations and sets out how the new body will carry out its functions, namely to negotiate pay, terms and conditions of police officers in Scotland. Our aim is to create a modern negotiating body in which consensus on the matters under its remit is the norm. However, the Constitution also sets out how conciliation and arbitration should be used when all other options are exhausted. The new Police Negotiating Board for Scotland will replace the Police Negotiating Board for the UK that now only extends to Scotland. This follows on from the abolition of the Police Negotiating Board in relation to England, Wales and Northern Ireland, where officers now have their pay considered through the Police Remuneration and Review Body. The new body will become operative on the 17th of August 2023. To help inform the development of these regulations, the current members of PNB, including Police Scotland, the Scottish Police Authority and staff associations, have been consulted on the detailed arrangements set out in these regulations. ACAS Scotland has been consulted on the arrangements for conciliation and arbitration. The views of these stakeholders have been taken into account. I can report that the PNB members agree that collective bargaining should be maintained, and they support the introduction of the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland. The regulations will give effect to the constitution of the Police Negotiating Board of Scotland, which has now been published. The regulations will disapply what would otherwise be mandatory statutory arbitration rules, and the regulations define qualifying cases, which are cases in respect of which ministers must take all reasonable steps appearing to them necessary for giving effect to the representations made to them following arbitration. The regulations disapply the mandatory rules made under the Arbitration Scotland Act 2010 and in the Constitution. PNBS members have set out that the default arbitration rules under the 2010 Act will not apply to the arbitration in the PNBS. Disapplying the rules will allow there to be continuity on arbitration procedures between the PNB UK and PNBS. ACAS Scotland will carry out conciliation and arbitration in line with the guidance set out under the Constitution. Arbitration findings are binding on the PNBS and would form the representations made to Scottish ministers. In 2016, Parliament agreed that ministers should take all reasonable steps to implement the findings of arbitration, but there was also agreement that this should be limited to two cases each year. The regulations and the constitution, therefore, set out the criteria for the two qualifying cases where ministers will take all reasonable steps to implement the findings of arbitration. There may be other disputes that go to arbitration in any given year, and ministers would consider the representations made by PNBS, but they would not be legally bound to take all reasonable steps to implement the findings. It should be noted that since 2014, when the PMB UK was abolished in England, Wales and Northern Ireland, there has not been a need for arbitration in Scotland. Pay terms and conditions claims in Scotland have been successfully agreed by the PMB. But it is right that police officers have the protection of arbitration set in legislation to provide the police staff associations with an agreed route to resolve disputes. Police officers are not employees, are not governed by normal industrial relations, and they can't withdraw their labour. They therefore need their terms and conditions set out in police regulations and to have a fair mechanism to negotiate and resolve disputes. We're also currently recruiting the first chairperson of the new body, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank Ian Mackay, the current chair of the PMB UK, for his 8 years' service in chairing the PMB. In these years, the PMB has agreed a range of changes to officers' terms and conditions and reached agreement each year on an annual pay award. I believe that the PMBS continues our commitment to collective bargaining and gives an effective voice for police officers. PNBS will provide them with a mechanism to discuss and negotiate their terms and conditions with the organisations that fund the service in Scotland. So happy to take any questions, Convener.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. So we'll move to questions now. And I wonder if I can just come in, first of all, I refer to a paper that the Scottish Police Federation had submitted to the committee ahead of today's meeting, in which they sort of outline their sort of position and their views on the proposals within the SSI. And within that, they make reference to the proposed constitution of the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland, and they've made a number of comments in and around the proposal. I'm not sure if you've had the opportunity to see those comments, but I just wondered if you have, if you had any comment to make on the points set out by the Scottish Police Federation in and around the comments that they've made.
I'm happy to answer any specific questions you have in any matters that have been raised directly with the committee, Convener.
Okay. Thanks. Well, on that note, I mean, they've made a number of comments. Whether or not there is scope to incorporate them at the moment, my understanding is that there isn't in the SSI. But if it's the case that you're not aware of them at the moment, then perhaps we'll come back to that, given that we're looking at the SSI in the format that it is at the moment.
As I said, I'm happy to answer any questions that the committee has. If there are matters that the Scottish Police Federation has raised, that's not a problem, Convener.
Yeah, well, that was my question. It
right.
was just if you had sight of the submission from the Scottish Police Federation and had an opportunity to consider some of the points that they'd made about the constitution.
Okay. I mean, it's important to recognise that from the government's perspective, we want to be actors in good faith. While I referred to in my speaking note that there hasn't been a need for arbitration procedures, for example, to be utilised in the past, I do consider in protecting ongoing arbitration arrangements, not as a sign of weakness, but as a sign of strength. It is absolutely imperative that, bearing in mind that police officers can't withdraw their labour, that they do have access to other mechanisms. This Parliament agreed, again, as I referred to in my speaking note, agreed in the 2016 Act that the government would have to take all reasonable steps to implement any arbitration agreement. I suppose if I could put that perhaps into more human speak, you know, we absolutely would seek to, in the spirit of fairness, fulfil any obligations placed upon the government in terms of arbitration. The wording in the legislation, it does say all reasonable steps. It's not uncommon for that kind of wording to appear in legislation. But, you know, other than very extreme circumstances, you know, the government accepts that there should be arbitration arrangements in place, that we would, you know, act in good faith and, you know, would seek to implement any arbitration decisions other than, you know, in some very exceptional circumstances. Mm-hmm. And I don't think our position has changed over, you know, successive terms of office.
Thanks very much. That's helpful. And I would just point out that in their submission, the Scottish Police Federation do say that they feel that the proposals are certainly relatively strong, and I'm quoting, relatively strong in our favour and in the spirit of fairness acceptable to the SPF. So thank you for that. So I'll now just open it up to other members for any other questions. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and
Good
other
morning.
Guests. So just following on from the Convener's opening line of questions, this submission from the SPF was dated 24th May 2023. It is addressed to the committee, but I did wonder if, just to clarify, whether the Cabinet Secretary had sight of it and had, if the government were intending to respond formally to the content therein, because it did make a number of very specific suggestions about changes to the Constitution that it would like to see, and I'm happy to go through them in public if it's helpful, but it would be quicker and easier if the government just responded en bloc to their suggestions. And I wondered if
okay.
the government, Cabinet Secretary was proposing to do that.
Yeah, OK. So in terms of picking up, you know, the core issue here is in around arbitration and the binding effect of it. So the 2016 Act is where we have legislated for almost binding arbitration. And that's the closest that we could get to binding Parliament and ministers. So that is a real high threshold in terms of binding the government. And I would hope that would be of considerable reassurance both to committee and also staff associations who have all been, you know, consulted, you know, on the regulations and the constitution. It is important to stress that, you know, we, I suppose there's three levels in terms of how the PNB will operate on a practical level. We've got the regulations, the constitution has been published, it's there, you know, therefore shared publicly, and the constitution is rooted in the regulations, but there is another layer below that in terms of the day-to-day operating guide, and that will be developed. In fact, it's currently being developed, but that will be for all parties within the police negotiating board to come to an agreement about their own processes.
Yeah, it's that second one, though, that I wanted to comment on. They obviously have seen the draft of, I presume it is a draft of the Constitution that's been published, and on a number of points, 3, 9, 37, 42, and 43, 44 and 45, have made specific comments as to its content. So I guess, going back to my original question, is will there be scope for that Constitution to be amended prior to being finalised?
Okay. So, yeah, the issue about the Constitution is referenced in regulations, and we are agreeing the regulations today in which the Constitution is rooted in. So it's been a matter for Parliament in terms of the legislation and regulation. It is now for the PNB to agree its own kind of day-to-day operations. I'll just check with officials that that correctly.
I think, if I haven't explained myself properly, you know, apologies. It's just to ensure that, though, that the very specific comments that they've made will be taken into account by the PNB as they finalise the wording of the Constitution.
No. So the Constitution is what has been published.
Right.
What I've tried to distinguish between that, so we have the regulations, the Constitution, and then there is the guide of the day-to-day operability of the working practices of the PNB. Maybe if I asked officials to give some practical examples of what will actually be in the guide, that might help.
Yeah, it would, and in doing so, perhaps they could make reference to the issues that the SPF raised, because they clearly have preempted perhaps some scenarios that might be problematic, and therefore they feel that they would need to be addressed in order to avoid any future deadlock, for example.
Okay. So we'll pick up specifically the point about deadlock. I mean, I think I've spoken effectively to the principal point and the importance of arbitration and acting in good faith, and that, you know, we would be accepting any arbitration decision other than, you know, very exceptional circumstances, and you would expect any government over any term to articulate that. And I think I've also addressed the issue that, you know, regulations are for Parliament, and the Constitution is rooted in the regulations, and the Constitution has been consulted on, and, you know, we've worked and negotiated on, and you know, we've come to a consensus and agreement on that. But I'll ask officials to address the issue of the guide and how that will be developed, and the type of issues that will be addressed. And your other point, Mr. Green, was I think you were worried about the arbitration process being stifled, about blockers being put on that.
Yeah, so very specifically on that, and it's worth putting on the record because this letter is a matter of public record. The feedback, certainly on sections 37 and 42 of the Constitution that I refer to by the SPF state, that there seems to be, and I'm quoting here, there seems to be scope for either of the sides to prevent such a matter going to arbitration, or for the chairperson to decide not to refer a matter to arbitration. This could lead to deadlock. They go on to say, it is hard to envisage the board failing to make a recommendation based on an arbitration award. It seems to open the door for either side to delay or block a PNB agreement based on an arbitration award, and this would be highly unsatisfactory. So I guess I'm looking for some feedback to that.
Yeah, so I mean, the whole purpose of arbitration is to avoid deadlock, and the whole purpose of having an independent chair is that if there is an inability to agree, they bring sides together, and normally it would be for both sides to agree that the matter needs to go to arbitration. But if the independent chair thought that one side or the other was blocking procedures, they therefore, in terms of the powers of the chair, have the ability to kick off the arbitration process. But I'll hand over to officials to give Mr. Green more detail.
Peter will be best placed.
Peter.
Yeah, I mean, that's the chair is there to, an independent chair is there to ensure that the process can be taken forward independently, and it would be for the chair to decide that all discussions have failed and the failure to agree would be taken to arbitration. So that we don't see that there would be a total block when there was a total failure in the process. And some of the other issues that I've seen from the Federation is real practical issues of how the body would manage certain issues about non-members being at committee, at working groups and meetings. That happens at the moment, and it'll be set out in the guide, the PNB guide, that the chair can invite, or the chairperson of a working group can invite non-members to meetings. And there's the other issue that was highlighted was about disagreements on how previous agreements were being implemented. And that's quite a technical process, and we didn't think that was for the Constitution. And the Constitution has been consulted on everybody, and it was agreed that that would go into the guide. So if there's a more technical discussion about how we implement an agreement, there'll be a process put in place where the sides will get together and discuss it, but we'll put in place a proper process for that in the guide.
Yeah, and you're right. They refer to a request to that sides may nominate persons who are not necessarily representatives to serve on subcommittees and working groups, but with permission of the chair, so I presume that permission will be carried forward in the new setup. I guess, you know, we have seen, and the reason it's important for us is we have seen in the past year or so where there has been a disagreement on pay settlements, and of course, Cabinet Secretary, you rightly raised the fact that they cannot perform the same type of strike action, for example, as other public services have or have threatened to. However, they have taken industrial action of a different type, and that has had an effect on clearly you know, their ability to carry out certain functions of, you know, resorting back to principal statutory duties and removed goodwill, if you like, and we've seen that happen already. And so I wonder if the new scenario is more or less likely to produce agreement on pay, knowing that there is a history of a disagreement on pay, and whether there be any alterations to what action police can and cannot take in the event of a dispute or indeed a deadlock.
So, I mean, there's no changes in terms of what police officers can and can't do in terms of whether that's withdraw goodwill. You know, we all know they can't withdraw their labour because they are office holders, not employees. I mean, this agreement that we are, you know, what we have reached in terms of these regulations are very much about continuity of a previous arrangement. Obviously, there is public scrutiny of these regulations, and the Constitution certainly gives ministers an opportunity to say that we'll participate in any process as fair actors. You know, we are committed as a government to collective pay bargaining and the principles of fair work. And in many ways, this is a bit of a legacy agreement. You know, we agreed the nuts and bolts of this in 2016, but now that there will be a new chair, you know, we need to move to a Scotland-only arrangement. Otherwise, I'll have to ask the Prime Minister to appoint the new chair. And, you know, I don't think we've used a system where a UK-wide system that has only actually been operable for Scotland for some years.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, absolutely.
So some of this is just about the practicalities.
Yeah, I understand that. Yeah, I think the problem with the continuity is, though, is that I think what people would be concerned about is continuity of the status quo, where we end up in a scenario where we have annual pay bargains that do end up in industrial dispute and the removal of services and goodwill by officers.
But the purpose of a PNB is for that negotiation to take place, and, you know, whether people are, I mean, I'm not speaking about specific pay claims here or specifics, because where there are processes, you know, they have to be respected, and there has to be an integrity to a process. But it is for those negotiating partners, whether they are, you know, doing annual pay deals, mm-hmm. or whether they're seeking, you know, something longer term. I mean, you know, some parts of the public sector have, you know, negotiated multi-year or two-year pay deals. So this is just about ensuring that we continue to have solid arrangements in place that are fair, and in particular fair to police officers who can't withdraw their labour.
Indeed, thank you. Thanks for that clarity. And just my final question is, what role would Scottish ministers play in any of these proceedings?
So in terms of how the PNB currently works, you have all the sides. So there are the staff associations, and you have the SPA, Police Scotland, and the government is there in terms of officials, mm-hmm. And then the PNB, you know, makes recommendations to ministers. That's the size of it, isn't it? I haven't missed anything out.
Okay, so the PNB makes recommendations to ministers. Is then up to ministers to approve or agree or disagree, or is it the final decision that the PNB's recommendations?
I mean, we would seek. Yeah, I mean, we would, because we are the government is in the room represented. We would, you know, seek to fulfil what the PNB agreed.
Right, because you supply their resource budget, therefore you have to sign off the chequebook.
So we're part of the negotiating process.
Okay.
Although I'm not personally sitting in PNB for all sorts of reasons you would understand.
Right, and does the government have any override function at all in terms of decisions that are made?
If all sides can't agree, it goes to arbitration, which we have always avoided in the past. That doesn't mean that we won't go to arbitration in the future. I don't view going to arbitration as a negative, actually. I mean, I think I'm on record as saying that I would view it as a strength, as a weakness, that we have built that into the system. I think the best way to describe it is a tripartite arrangement. So the agreement is between Police Scotland, SPA and SG. So they're the three partners that we need to, from the employer side, if you like, we'd have to agree to fund.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. Russell Finlay.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning. In the Annex A, the policy note from the Scottish Government, it says this instrument allows for the preparation and publication of the Constitution of the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland. But I think, if I understand you correctly, that's now been published. The Constitution has been published. Rather than this allows for the preparation and publication.
So I've got... Yes, so when was the Constitution published?
The Constitution is linked and has been. It was published so that it forms part of, it comes under the regulations, but it's already been published so that it's in place for these regulations.
So the purpose of the instrument says allows for the preparation and publication, but it's happened already. It's been published.
The Constitution was consulted through the members and published so that as soon as the regulations come into place, the Constitution is ready.
And the Constitution, was that submitted to the Criminal Justice Committee? Have we got sight of that?
It's part of the... It's a link off the regulations, so it's part of the regulations.
Okay.
So it's part of the package. You know, in the same way, you've got the regulations, the policy note, it's referenced, and it was... the date I've got, and this is May 2023.
And I know Jamie Green's touched on this already, but the Scottish Police Federation's submission to the committee, has the government seen that?
So you're talking about the correspondence May 24?
Yes.
May 23rd, yes.
Because they effectively raised 5 points about the Constitution, one of which, in fact, probably could deal with the other four, in that it talks about the first one, Section 3, that the board would be allowed to consider matters affecting its own constitution. Has that been listened to and rejected by the government, or is this news to the government?
No, it's not news to the government, but it is a matter for Parliament in terms of law and regulations. The lawyer will keep me right, but it wouldn't be a matter for the PNB to be changing its constitution, so that's the purpose.
But the constitution's just been published after consultation.
So it's published May 2023, but I think
you were so minded, the issues the Federation's raised, the very specific issues.
So I think we've actually, with respect, but happy to repeat them or go over in more detail any of the issues. I think it's well within Parliament's rights here, bearing in mind the 2016 Act, and that it's for Parliament to pass regulations. I don't think it would be the norm for the PNB to be changing its own constitution. It could, of course, you know, come back to ministers who at some point, you know, in the fullness of time, if there was something inoperable about the constitution that could be changed. But I'm very conscious that, you know, there's time and effort being invested around coming to, you know, an agreement around the constitution, and I think MSPs would be well within their rights to be somewhat concerned that if these matters, you know, weren't dealt by Parliament via regulations, that if matters of constitution for this very important body were dealt in a more ad hoc way,
But we can't amend what's in front of us today.
No.
The Scottish Police Federation have brought to us five quite specific concerns. Uh-huh. I'm still not entirely clear as to whether they've been considered by the government, mm-hmm. because they don't feature in the constitution, which has now been published, or whether there's any scope for the government to look at that again and amend the constitution.
So I suppose to be blunt, I think we have the highest level of expectations on binding arbitration that is possible on the Scottish Government. So that was one of the issues raised by the Federation. And in my view, I think I have addressed that. I have addressed the matter to committee around who, where and when is appropriate for regulations vis-a-vis constitutions. In terms of the issue about, I think it was 37A and B in the correspondence, in terms of being able to bring in non-members of the board. By that, I assume people mean, you know, different experts to come and give advice or an input. You know, these things, you know, currently happen. That would be a matter for the PNB in its normal day-to-day process, as opposed to setting that out in a matter of the constitution. So it would be my view that we have addressed these points, and, you know, happy to continue to do so with committee. But no, the nature of these regulations and how they can't be amended is, of course, rooted in the 2016 Act. But I'll just check in case officials want to add anything.
Nothing from you, Peter.
I think just to make it clear that under the 2016 Act, the constitution has to be given effect to by Parliament via regulations. So what these regulations do is give effect to the constitution, which was published recently after consultation with the various parties. The constitution's not set in stone forever. It can be revised, but any revisions would have to take place via the same process. So that means they would need to be referred to in regulations, which would go through a parliamentary process, and the same consultation process as was followed for these regulations would need to happen again for any revisions. And that's the way the process works. Okay.
So just for clarification, when you say parties, you're talking about the various entities who've got interest in this, not political parties.
Yes.
So the Scottish Police Federation presumably at that stage made these points, and whatever the decision-making process arrived at was the constitution as published.
So what they're
now referring to is kind of water under the bridge. There's no real...
I don't know if they did make these points, and policy officials would be able to confirm that.
So, I mean, just to say, I met with the Scottish Police Federation. I would have to check the date in my diary, but it's not that long ago. I mean, it could have been 3 weeks ago. These issues weren't raised with me. I have seen the letter that was sent to committee on the 24th of May. I didn't see it on the 24th of May, but you wouldn't expect me to be privy to correspondence that was sent to committee.
I'm slightly uncomfortable with the fact they've made a couple of comments in their submission about this being weaker than what they would have liked, although they're sort of grudgingly accepting of it. They make some very specific points, and I'm still not entirely clear whether there's any mechanism for the government to look again at these points, potentially.
So, not today, perhaps in the fullness of time, if the PNB and the, you know, was finding that any of these matters were in some way affecting their substantive business. I mean, my view here and now, and I'm just going to be dead direct, is that I think we have address these matters. There is nothing raised in these matters that would prevent the passing of the regulations. I do think some of the issues would certainly be matters for the guide, which would be developed in consultation with all PNB members. I think some of these issues are much more about the day-to-day working of the PNB. You know, so you don't need to have in the constitution that non-members can come and make representations to, you know, a subcommittee or to the main PNB.
Yeah. Okay. So, thank you.
Okay. If I can maybe just come in and clarify, just the picking up the point that you were asking about in relation to what are the options today, as it were. So obviously we're aware that the Federation has made a number of recommendations to amend the SSI, and I think as the Cabinet Secretary has pointed out, it's not possible for the committee for our committee to do this insofar as SSIs come to committee in their form and as they are, and either we agree them or we don't. So the only option available to members is, if members wish to see changes, is to vote against the motion this morning, or to see, obviously, if there is scope for the SSI to be withdrawn and brought back in a revised version. And I think from what you've been saying, Cabinet Secretary, that's not something that you would be mindful to do. So I hope that provides some clarity. I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, if I may, and then I'll come back to Russell, to Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, just to say, I mean, with respect to my colleagues, I think they're making this much more complicated than it needs to be. I think the Cabinet Secretary and our officials have clearly stated that this is about bringing continuity and a fair process for police officers in Scotland. And I think we've been kind of going down a rabbit hole a bit here with all these questions. So I'm quite content for this to go ahead.
Thanks very much. And Jamie, you wanted to come back in?
Thank you. I mean, the rabbit hole we're going to is based on the evidence we have in our committee papers from one of the leading protagonists of the negotiations. So I think it's absolutely right that we raise them, given that they're not here to give us evidence prior to this. I think the problem we have, really, is more of a procedural one, and that's that, from what I can understand, there is a potential to revise the Constitution, but that would need to be done under regulation. And I guess my point is, what is the point of passing a regulation to rubber stamp the Constitution as it is now, knowing that there are stakeholders who wish to see changes, to then have to come back to Parliament with future regulations with those changes? Why don't we do it in one go? And the better thing for the government, in my view, would be to have that discussion with those who have presented as evidence. And if there are any necessary changes to the Constitution that have to be made, come back with a regulation and we do it as a one-hit wonder. I've got no problem with the regulation, but I do have a problem being asked to rubber stamp the Constitution, by which clearly some stakeholders have problems with.
Thank you very much. Any other members want to come in? Just finally, Russell.
Yeah, very quickly. You know, I agree with Rona that we all want a system that helps police officers get a fair pay settlements. That goes without saying. And as for our rabbit hole, I think it's perfectly proper that we ask these questions, because we've not even seen as a committee the constitution that's going to be adopted. The papers suggest that this is going to be published. We now discover that it has been published. And I fully agree with Jamie that if we're going to, or rather to rubber stamp this today, would be a missed opportunity for the government to go back to the Scottish Police Federation and just address these points. I think it's probably worth revisiting.
Keith, thank you very much. So just to kind of try and pull this together, I appreciate the points that have been made by members and the Cabinet Secretary's responses to those. I think just it's probably important just to clarify that what the Federation seemed to be seeking is that the wording of the Constitution be amended, and I think what we have heard, and I make specific reference to the update from Louise Miller, was that down the line the Constitution can be amended, and that would be a separate process from agreeing the SSI in its current form today. So can I just maybe ask if that what I've just said is correct?
So So let me firstly say I have no objections to answering any questions brought forward by committee members. And let me just respond to the convener and in hopefully a way that's helpful and clear, and I'll do my best to be succinct. The process in which we are all now following was set in the 2016 legislation. There was, with the papers, you know, in terms of the constitution, you know, people, you know, may or may not choose to read links or to print links or whatever, but I mean the information has been made available. I don't think there are many more ways in which I can commit to our, the way in which the government values and sees the importance of arbitration and, you know, as always working in good faith and as a good actor. There are some matters in the correspondence from the Police Federation that could be addressed through the guide, as agreed by all the PNB members. I am conscious, and of course with the great respect to the Police Federation, who my understanding was they were certainly broadly content, there are other partners and other staff associations that, you know, were involved in this process as well, and you know, they haven't made any representations, to the best of my knowledge, to committee. So we have a situation that people, you know, are happy to move forward. As with any set of arrangements, people, of course, and it's within the right of the Police Federation or any other party to be boren down into the detail. But that will now, in my view, be a matter for the guide, which all partners will work collaboratively to develop. But I think it is, convener, time that we moved on to have a police negotiating board for Scotland, as opposed to using a legacy arrangement of a UK body. If I may, I think the police negotiating board scenario with arbitration, with the protection of arbitration built in, is far preferable, again in my view and in the government's view, to a police review, police pay review body that exists down south, which is not a negotiating body, and, you know, can make recommendations to the Home Secretary because it's accountable to the Home Secretary, and of course there's a pattern there of recommendations not being accepted, and I think I've put on record in the strongest possible term that we want to and will continue to enter all of this in good faith and accept the principles and purpose of arbitration.
Okay, thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. So hopefully that has been helpful and provided some clarity for members. So on that note, I'll now move on to inviting the Cabinet Secretary to move SSI number S6M number 08783, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the Police Negotiating Board for Scotland Constitution, Arbitration and Qualifying Cases Regulations 2023 be approved.
Moved, convener.
Thank you very much. So the question is that motion S6M 08783 in the name of Angela Constance be agreed. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Okay, thank you very much indeed. So can I finally invite members to agree to delegate to me and the clerks the publication of a short factual report on the SSI? Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary, and officials for joining us today. Thank you. We'll just have a short pause to let the Cabinet Secretary leave. Okay, and in fact, that concludes our business for the morning. There's no formal committee meeting next week as planned. I will close the meeting. Thank you.